the installation and a free month of monitoring service. Vivid, smart security professionally installed. Call 833-420-4070 to get started today. Offer valid for new customers only. System purchase requires monthly service agreement and equipment package. Speak to a Vivint representative today for complete equipment, services, and financing details. Visit Vivint.com for licensing information. Other terms and conditions may apply.
Attention all authors. Page Publishing is looking for authors. Have you written a book and want to get it published? Page Publishing will get your book into bookstores and for sale online at Amazon, Apple iTunes, and other outlets. They handle all aspects of the publishing process for you. Printing, cover art, publicity, copyright, and editing. Call 800-501-3689 now for your free author submission kit. That's 800-501-3689 for your free author submission kit. Again, 800-501-3689.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, U.S. Tax Shield can help you take back control. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Our team of tax attorneys can stop collections and get you protected. U.S. Tax Shield offers a price protection guaranteed quote to get you protected today. U.S. Tax Shield is A-plus rated with the BBB, so call 800-466-9625. U.S. Tax Shield, 800-466-9625.
The IRS, the world's most aggressive collection agency. They can seize your property, bank account, and garnish your wages. They cause sleepless nights for millions of Americans. Don't be one of them. If you owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, get protected today. Call 800-312-9970. Coast One Tax Group, protecting your bank, home, and your sleep since 2008. With hundreds of five-star reviews and an A-plus on the Better Business Bureau. Call Coast One Tax Group. 800-312-9970. Stanley from New York owed $93,000. The IRS placed a levy on his bank account. Coast One released the levy and settled with the IRS for $2,000. Mark in Michigan owed $225,000. After Coast One stepped in, Mark walked away paying less than $1,500. Call Coast One now. A 10-minute call can save you up to 93% on your back taxes. Get your fresh start today. That's 800-312-9970.
Welcome to the best country music of yesterday and today. This is Real Country Radio, 92.5 and 96.5.
I was a highwayman. Along the coach roads I did ride, with sword and pistol by my side. A young maid lost her baubles to my trade. Many a soldier shed his lifeblood on my blade. The bastards hung me in the spring of 25, but I am still alive.
I was a sailor, I was born upon the tide. I did abide. I sailed a schooner around the Horn of Mexico. I went aloft to furl the mainsail in a blow. And when the yards broke off, they said that I got killed. But I'm living still. I was a dam builder across a river deep and wide, where steel and water did collide. A place called Boulder on the Wild Colorado. I slipped and fell into the wet concrete below. They buried me in that gray tomb that knows no sound, but I'm still around. I'll always be around and around and around and around and around. I fly a starship across the universe divide, and when I reach the other side, I'll find a place to rest my spirit if I can. Perhaps I may become a highwayman again.
Here's the Highwayman. It's Real Country. Looks like Luke Combs is going to do a virtual concert. He says that his team recorded his shows on his last tour, and it would be pretty cool to be able to post a full show to watch all the camera angles and everything. And that looks like it's going to happen on Thursday, February 18th. Here's Luke with Love It On You on Real Country.
Don't get me wrong, I like a bobber on the water, hooking up and reeling, man. I like a Friday night slow ride, Brooks and Dunn, Bayside, Harry White, spinning again. I like a strong shot of whiskey, the way a Marlboro hits me, some broken in cowboy boots.
Classic country favorites.
Well, I work a double shift at the plant and I work on the outside. Not a lot, I'd rather be back home making love to my new bride. Well, there's only two things that I want when I'm back in my double wide, and that's a big old brew and a little old you. Now I know you're working every day just as hard as I do. If I didn't think that, I might have loved you, but I wouldn't have said I do. And there's only two things in the world I need to get close to, and that's a big old brew and a little old you. Well, I got both ends of meeting in the middle, but I can't seem to get them tied. I don't care, long as I know you'll be by my side. Seem to get them tired. my side. When I ain't gonna work as hard every day.
Hope this pipe.
One of these days, everything that I want's gonna be mine. But if it ain't, that'll be alright as long as there's sunshine and a big old brew. And a little old you. I'll take a big old brew. And I'll take a little old you.
On 920 WGHQ.
Good morning. You're now listening to Kingston Community Radio, airing on FM 92.5 and AM 920 WGHQ, Kingston, New York. This programming is brought to you by our listeners and corporate underwriters who are interested in presenting local community radio. The opinions expressed on this program do not represent those of PAML Broadcasting or Kingston Community Radio. Listeners are encouraged to send in $10 per month to help bring this program to you and mail your contributions to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. For more information, or to donate online, visit our website at mykcr.org. And good morning, this is Dan Gatiss, and thank you for tuning in, sharing the morning with us, being a part of today's Medical Monday, Monday, February 15th, 16 degrees here right now in Uptown Kingston. And today is variable cloudiness with a 50% chance of snow showers, a high of 27, less than an inch possible, though, today. Tonight, 100% chance of snow this evening, changing to freezing rain overnight, a low of 25. Tuesday, mostly cloudy, a 90% chance of periods of rain early, a high of 43. Tuesday night, partly cloudy, low down to 16. Wednesday, sunny with some afternoon clouds, a high of 31. And Wednesday night, back down to 16 degrees. And we'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
My mother was very familiar with her neighborhood, but one day she stopped at the stop sign and she wasn't even really sure where she was at.
When something feels different, it could be Alzheimer's. Now is the time to talk. A message from the Alzheimer's Association and the Ad Council.
The Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America invites you to take steps for cures at a walk near you. Support the 1.6 million Americans living with these diseases. Get started at cctakesteps.org.
Everyone is talking about healthcare these days. America spends twice that of other developed countries on our healthcare system, yet our health ranks near the bottom. How can we stop spending so much and getting so little? By shifting to a system that gives more patients access to strong primary care. Primary care can help make America healthy again. To learn more about the benefits of primary care, visit www.healthisprimary.org. This message is brought to you by America's Family Physicians.
Hi, this is Anne Marie from the great town of Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
You're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ 920, on your AM dial 92.5 FM and streaming online at mykcr.org. KCR is talk radio and a call-in show. Our call-in line is 331-9255, 845-331-9255. And let's get to the on-air studio. Dr. Eric Stamberg is bringing us in with Medical Monday. Welcome.
All right, good morning. Welcome to this morning's show. It is February 15th, the middle of the month, I guess, so to speak. And it's going to be a little wintry out there today, right? A little slick?
A little bit of, you know, it calls for snow today, but it was freezing rain.
I didn't call for snow.
Yeah, I know. No way.
Somebody called.
Yep.
All right, so I'll be here till 9 a.m. Robin Baker will be joining me, and I did have a guest who actually called in kind of sick, to be honest with you. She and I, you know, we'll talk about it later this morning, but she had her shot, the famous shot, and a lot going on with that, and we'll get to it. I I was very impressed by going into a CVS on Saturday and seeing their setup to administer the shot. I was a little cautious about this. But they were it was hopping in there, and they were doing it. They had a special.
Yeah. Wow, a local CVS?
Yeah, right on the one on Washington 9W there. They're all
down on 9W.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm not quite sure how you sign up for it. I bet it's probably online, and
I think it's to their to the pharmacy's website. People that are already members of the pharmacy or get their prescriptions from it probably have instant access to it because you have the app or you have the the contacts. For your prescriptions, anyway.
My first clue when I got in, it was pretty crowded in the parking lot. I was kind of like, well, these can't be all people getting last minute Valentine's Day cards. So I was very, when I walked in there, there seemed to be a bunch of children escorting their parents to their elderly parents to come get the vaccine. But it was hopping in there, and I was impressed. I was talking about the CVS giving out the COVID vaccinations on Saturday when I went into the store on 9W there.
Yeah, crowded.
Yeah, and there was a table to sign up, and then in the back there was I think there was a couple kind of different settings where people were administering the shot. So I was a little concerned about that. I was concerned that they were just going to, like, I don't know, the busy pharmacists were going to now have to do this on top of everything else, and that were they going to have more staffing for it? And they seemed to have it, so I was glad.
It's good.
Yes. Good morning, Ms. Baker.
Good morning.
We did have a guest, but she actually called in sick because she had received, our friend Dr. Agricola, who's been on the show before. She'll be back in the coming weeks, but she had received the shot and was not feeling well.
Right.
So we've talked about that a lot. So should we do the COVID first or later? What do you think?
Let's wait.
Okay. Well, I did in my usual fashion, just kind of talk about some general medical topics, because I think they're interesting.
Yes, I agree.
It's funny how we got very few topics in medicine that are reintroduced with the. You have the flu, for example. You have a cold, but you get the flu. We don't say you have the COVID. You have COVID. It's interesting, but with the topic that we talk about called gout. Have you ever talked about that before?
Referred to as the gout?
Sometimes it is called the gout. It has an article in front of it. The gout. And why am I bringing this up? Because I think a lot of people have this, and I think a lot of people kind of suffer with it. And I think people who are even diagnosed with it are really not completely treated correct, completely. The focus, if someone has recurrent gout, is really to be on more of a preventative measure with gout rather than kind of an episodic one.
Right. So you kind of want to catch it ahead of time as opposed to treat it afterwards.
Yeah. Kind of, and so gout is is kind of a type of arthritis. Arthritis simply means inflammation in a joint. So, hey, I have arthritis. Well, there are different types, and gout is usually an acute arthritis, so it's kind of a sudden onset, and it's usually almost always monoarticular, which means one joint. So you don't wake up with all your joints aching and say, I have gout. It tends to be an isolated joint. The most common site is the famous big toe, the first metatarsal phalangeal joint. And then everyone has, the image of King Louis the 14th or whatever with his toe in a bandage and while he's chomping on a turkey leg and drinking some, what do they drink?
Wine, I would assume.
No, mead. What is it called? Mead.
Mead.
What are they drinking then?
Mead.
Yeah. Mead, yes.
Yes. What's that, honey? That's a honey beer.
Okay.
Or a honey wine. Good. Honey wine. Yeah.
And in the cartoons, the image of like the shoe being cut out, just the one.
With the toe,
yeah,
right.
Just the toe sticking out.
All right. So that's the most common joint that affects is the big toe. But it really can affect any major joint in your body. A lot of times it can affect the foot itself. That's called the mid-tarsal or tarsal joints. It can affect the ankle. The knee is probably the second most common. And it can affect the upper extremity joints as well. I've seen it in the wrist, for example, and the elbow.
So what changes it from being arthritis to being the gout?
The gout. Well, the gout is a specific type of arthritis. And it's usually one joint and only one joint. And even though it has some kind of subsets of how it manifests, it most commonly shows up as an acute onset. And the pain is severe. It comes on pretty suddenly. Someone, for example, in the toe will say that they get so painful they can't even put the sheet on top of it. They will literally, you know, take their blanket, have the foot hanging out while they're trying to sleep. And sleep is very difficult while you're having acute gout, because the pain is that severe. And it will last, 2 to 3 days, and actually kind of subside on its own if you did nothing. But it is quite painful. Make it hard for someone to walk, for example. It's caused by uric acid crystals. Uric acid is kind of a byproduct of our body's metabolism. You know, it's a waste product, and it's excreted by the kidneys. So, and anything that causes this uric acid to accumulate, be high, higher than it should be, will predispose someone to gout. One very common reason people have gout is they have just on the level of their kidneys, they don't excrete enough. So there is a genetic component to gout as well. And also people who kind of make a lot of byproduct, people with more body mass will make uric acid. It's just by their normal metabolism, and therefore there'll be more, and the kidneys maybe can't excrete it all, and therefore it will travel around the body and then potentially depose itself in a joint. Does that make sense?
So the uric acid, you should be excreting when you urinate.
Yeah.
But sometimes it just hops out of the kidney.
The kidneys almost kind of, the way to think of it is they almost can't keep up, either the kidneys themselves can't do it, or there's just so much being produced. For example, uric acid is also very relevant for people like undergoing chemotherapy, where you're literally trying to kill a bunch of cancer cells. And when they die, they release the uric acid. That uric acid load can then, accumulate and cause someone gout. So that's almost part of the treatment, is to prevent it from happening.
Does it happen to everyone? I mean, like every age, both genders?
I don't know if it really shows up in the pediatric setting unless someone has another problem, but it can be seen in young adults. It is more common as someone gets older for a couple of reasons. One is the kidneys kind of trickle down. That's a nice pun I made there. But their ability to excrete the uric acid kind of diminishes over time, so accumulates. And people also, as they get a little bit older, maybe they get a little heavier. Their body's making more uric acid. So we'll get back to dietary measures, because it is very important in how to treat this and prevent it. What else? Uric acid. Okay, so treating gout when someone has it is you want to treat the inflammation. And to some degree, just ibuprofen works and Aleve. Those are anti-inflammatories. The Tylenol probably might take away some of your pain, but it's not going to decrease your inflammation. So that's just something to keep in mind. And other medications that are commonly used are steroids. I use those a lot for acute gout, like what's called a medrol dose pack. The first category, NSAIDs, which is anti-inflammatories, ibuprofen, Aleve, and then a whole slew of prescription anti-inflammatories that could be used. One that's used a lot is called indomethacin or Indocin. Very potent, but it really has a lot of side effects. The side effects are it can upset the stomach and even cause ulcers. I worry a lot about kidney function with NSAIDs. You talk to any, Dr. Lee, our friend, the nephrologist, he's constantly, saying, stop with the NSAIDs, stop with the NSAIDs. They're really just not good for the kidneys. It's complicated. I'm not even sure I can remember the basics of the physiology. They can also cause some fluid retention, so they're really not particularly good for, someone like maybe some heart problems, like heart failure. So steroids, on the other hand, don't have a negative effect on kidney function. What they do, though, is they can raise someone's sugar. So if someone is a diabetic and particularly has a hard time managing it, steroids may not be a good choice. Steroids can also be very stimulating, and sometimes in a good way. Just some jokes I've heard over the years. The woman will say, or I'm saying a woman, I don't know, but a woman will say, I cleaned my house from all over because I had so much energy. But sometimes it causes like almost like a negative energy, like a too much cup of coffee type of energy. Anyway, people say they can't sleep, for example, because of the steroid. And another medication that's used in the setting of acute gout is something called colchicine. It's an old medicine. It's an interesting medicine because it was a generic and actually rather cheap. It's one of the few medicines that somehow went from generic to brand again. What happened was the FDA decided that the traditional colchicine had too many side effects. So they came up with kind of a newer form that's longer acting. That's under the brand called Colchris. And therefore, something that used to be kind of cheap became expensive. It's a good medicine, though. And dietary changes. You have to limit your purine-rich foods. Purine. That's like a breakdown product of protein. So where do you get it from? Well, meat. You know, and certain meats are very high in uric acid. I'm sorry, in purines. And how the purine leads to uric acid is very complicated. I'm not so sure I'm going to get into it here. But organ meats are very high in uric acid, but I don't know who's eating that too much, other than maybe people eating some liver. You know anyone who's eating brains?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes, and hearts and those type of things. They
I don't know about hearts. And meat, like venison, for example, is very high in purine. And a lot of people hunt up here and eat venison. So it's just something to keep in mind. Certain shellfish are high in purine as well. Again, it's complicated, but beer is a big problem. And then just alcohol in general. Although don't take this the wrong way, but wine is actually not that bad. People who are on diuretics, very commonly used medication, hydrochlorothiazide, chlorthalidone, furosemide, those are three common medications that people are on, will raise your uric acid as a side effect. So that's something, it's one thing I look at when I have a patient with gout. I go, you know, we always want to review their meds, and if someone does not need to be on that diuretic, you should consider discontinuing it and seeing if that improves it. And interestingly enough, a specific medication called Losartan. Losartan is a member of a class of medication called angiotensin receptor blockers. But that class of medicine has about 7 or 8 members in it. But this one called Losartan has a specific side effect where it increases and improves the excretion of uric acid. So that's something I try to do as well when someone has gout and hypertension to potentially put them on this medication. So what are risk factors for gout? We talked about a few already. Diuretic use, alcohol use, having hypertension increases the risk. I'm not really sure why I was trying to review that. Is it maybe just because of the side effect of medications, or is it just because kind of this elevated metabolism state that hypertension kind of puts you in? Being overweight, having a BMI greater than 30. Drinking too many sweet beverages. I know that contradicts a little bit with what I just said about wine, but what I meant was that wine, relative to other alcohol drinks, has a lower risk. But people who drink, we mentioned seafood and meat.
So sweet drinks means juice, right?
Yeah, anything high in fructose. What has fructose? Juice, right?
I would have to look that up, but...
Okay, so if someone has gout, they come in and they, you know, maybe they give a nice story. You know, doc, I was doing fine. And then all of a sudden, you know, within an hour, this big toe joint started to swell and get red and be exquisitely painful. You know, help me. You know, that's a nice story. And you know, this is where kind of we talked a lot about telemed over the years. I mean, a physical exam is kind of helpful. You know, it's something you can't really do on the telemed. I guess the patient can lift her toe up to the monitor and show it to me. So that's usually a very easy diagnosis. It has to be suspected when it's in the other joints, but it still can be made. So you want to initially treat the inflammation, and we talked about how to do that with either NSAIDs, steroids, or something called colchicine. Should you check, have your uric acid checked? That's a good question. For years, it was said when someone has an attack of gout, the body is kind of consuming the uric acid. So the uric acid level at the time of an attack of gout may be deceptively low. And I don't know, you know, we talk a lot in medicine about, is that evidence-based? Was that ever studied? Is it just something that was said over the years? I still think it's kind of a good rule. I usually try to avoid checking the uric acid while someone's having an attack, you know, and there's an advantage of having someone in kind of a, in my regular office rather than the urgent care setting where I could say, okay, I think this is gout, let's treat it like this, and I'm going to give you a lab slip. I want you to get it in 3 to 4 weeks, and we're going to check your uric acid and see what we get.
When you're not having the acute problem.
Right. There are times where I run it acutely. The problem is, if it's high, it helps you make your diagnosis. But if it's normal, it may be low because the patient's in the middle of an acute attack of gout. So that's why it's of limited benefit. Some people should go on preventative medication to keep the gout in check. Gout, in addition to causing that acute arthritis, that acute pain in the joint, it does have some other effects over time. It can kind of cause a low-grade arthritis, kind of eat away your joints a little bit as well. And then it also, ironically, affects the kidneys. We already said it's kind of caused by the kidneys because the kidneys can't excrete enough uric acid. But it's affected by the kidneys because, it affects the kidneys. A couple things can happen. One is if you have too much uric acid, body's will succeed in excreting it, but then it's going to get stuck and cause uric acid stones. Around 10% of people with kidney stones will be of uric acid type. and it also can affect the kidney itself. That's called gout nephropathy. It's kind of complicated, but it's not a benign entity. So if someone has recurrent attacks, and there's a little disagreement on how many to justify some long-term treatment. But I usually think if someone has, I'll say more than two. If someone comes in to see me and they, have gout, first thing I would do is maybe talk to them about some lifestyle changes. Losing some weight, making these changes in your diet. But if they continue to have it and that uric acid is also elevated, you should put them on preventative treatment. The most commonly used medication is something called allopurinol. And what that does is it interferes with the production of the uric acid. There's also something called, let me see if I'm going to say this right, febuxostat, under the brand called Euloric. This is a good example of marketing in medicine because Euloric came out a couple of years ago for gout, in the ads, on the television, it's really not better than allopurinol. It's not a bad choice for some. Actually, allopurinol can be a problem with someone who has, again, kidney function. So it's a good choice to some extent, but it has its own side effects. So it's really not necessarily better. It's really for someone who just can't tolerate allopurinol. Sometimes we do put the patient on a daily colchicine. We talked about that, the one that became a brand after being generic. And then there's another old treatment called probenecid. I don't have to get into with that. And what else? See if I left anything out. So once someone has recurring gout, you really want to get that uric acid below a certain level. So that's a common problem as well. People are they're on the medicine, but the dose isn't right. They have to have it checked. And if it's still high, it means they're at increased risk of having attacks. And therefore, you got to increase the dose. I think that's it for gout.
The gout.
Do you ever know anyone with gout?
Yes, actually, lots of people.
How did it manifest for them?
They suffer. I mean, it's a very, very painful thing that happens to people. So when it does occur, I don't know, it kind of takes you down. You know, it's like, right, you can't sleep, you can't really walk,
in the toe. Usually,
yeah, yeah, and the knee.
I've seen it in the knee, and the knee can really make it swell. And sometimes you have to actually withdraw fluid from the knee, and you could actually send it for testing and analysis, and uric acid crystals can be observed in the fluid of the knee. That is one other potential treatment for acute gout that we didn't talk about, which is a injection of steroid into the joint. The big toe is kind of a small. The big toe is kind of a small joint. It's a little challenging, but you know, a podiatrist does this a lot. You know, the knee is kind of easier. We have interesting terms in medicine. It's something called pseudo gout, which is, you know,
it seems like gout.
Seems like gout.
Looks like gout.
Yeah, and that's actually caused by calcium crystals. That could be seen in the knee and the shoulder. Can manifest the same way. You know, gout really, I don't think it affects the shoulder, but the pseudo gout can. And there's a few other types. But any acute onset, one joint, not more than one joint. Have I ever seen it at more than one joint? Not really. I've seen people kind of complain about an adjacent joint, but I think it's just kind of pain that's radiating. You know, if they're, for example, if they have gout in their ankle, they might also say it hurts in the knee. But I think it's just because the whole leg is so painful.
Does the word gout mean anything?
Oh, boy. We'd have to look it up. I mean, it's got to be, you know, it's an old, old term. But, you know, that would be interesting. These terms are interesting. And just a few take-homes, though, which is the importance of lifestyle modification, you know, weight loss and dietary adjustments. To also review your medications, people who are on diuretics will have increased risk of gout. So the value of the need for that diuretic has to be assessed. And look, some people need it. Some people have heart failure, but and they need to be on furosemide, for example. So you might be in a position of managing a side effect rather than eliminating the medication because that's not an option. And that happens a lot in medicine. All right. So just in general, some orthopedic problems. I had the privilege recently of giving a lecture to the family practice residents over at Northern Dutchess. You know, we have a program there. It's about 2 years old now. We're only in its second year. Kingston has a family practice program, of which I am a graduate. That has really been, I think, about 35 years. You know, it's pretty neat. We hear that a lot. There's going to be a shortage of primary care physicians. So there have been more family practice programs that have been developed. I think not that far away, Middletown, for example, has one as well that's relatively new. There used to be one in Poughkeepsie at Vassar, which ironically, you know, got rid of it about 20 years ago. I didn't see the value in it. That vision of the, you know. But I think they've come around. You know, the New Vance has really gotten into the residency business, full throttle there, you know.
Through Marist, right?
Not yet. I mean, there are plans for what's a Marist Medical School. I don't even know where that stands. I hear different reports about whether or not it's still on or not. You know, that's a big undertaking. You don't need to have a medical school necessarily to have residency programs. Usually you do want to have an academic affiliation of some sort. I don't think we have that, but that's okay. These are community-based programs. By the way, I think the Marist Medical School is a great idea. I think Poughkeepsie is a community that can support it, Dutchess and Ulster neighboring counties. And it reminds me a lot of New Brunswick, New Jersey, where I went to medical school, you know, Poughkeepsie. And, but it's a big undertaking. You know, you have to make a faculty, you have to get students, you have to make curriculum. You know, it's not going to pay for itself. And so I don't know, maybe I'll be on the faculty, but I'll probably be close to retiring by the time that happens. I'll be an emeritus professor before I'm a regular professor. I don't think I would ever be a professor. I would maybe be an instructor or whatever.
Right. What are they called? Professors that consult.
Professors that consult?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, in the medical school context, you could be an instructor, but you don't necessarily be a professor. A professor connotes some sort of, academic role, that you're doing some research or something along those lines, you know. So I consider myself an instructor now. And I have had appointments through various medical schools at times as an instructor. It's been something that I've been proud of.
And how did the lecture go with your students?
We'll revisit it after our break, because I think what we talked about is relevant for our listeners. So 17 seconds, 16 seconds. I got to go back to radio school here. Robin, can you count?
We'll be right back after the break.
All right. There you go, Dan.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Eric Stamberg and Robin Baker. It's 7:30 a.m. this Monday, February 15th morning, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. You are listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. And my name is Dan Gatiss, and here is the weather for the next 3 days. Variable clouds with a 50% chance of snow showers today. A high of 27, less than an inch of snow, though. Tonight, 100% chance of snow. This evening will change to freezing rain, a low of 25. Tuesday, mostly cloudy, a 90% chance of periods of rain early, a high of 43. And Tuesday night, partly cloudy, a low down to 16. And Wednesday, sunny with some afternoon clouds with a high up to 31. And Wednesday night, partly cloudy, mostly cloudy overnight, back down to 16. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Don't. Just don't. If you see a low-hanging or downed wire, don't touch it. Don't move it. Don't go near it. Don't drive over it. It may be a power line carrying an electric current strong enough to kill. But here's what to do. Stay at least 30 feet away and call 911. Central Hudson will take care of the problem. If you come close to a wire, shuffle away with small steps and watch your step. Wires may be hidden in fallen tree limbs or near water. Your safety matters.
Hey, Dad, your prescription will be ready in just a minute. Hey, Dad, your laundry will be ready in just a minute. Dad, your lunch will be ready in just a minute.
Hey, honey, why don't you take a minute?
When you help care for a loved one, you give them as much time as you can. But it's just as important to take time for yourself. AARP can help. Find free care guides to support you and your loved one at aarp.org/caregiving. That's aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Cameron Rylance from Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio because it's informative.
And we're back. You're with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. 7:32 AM, 25 degrees on this Monday, February 15th. And this upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Central Hudson. And let's get back to our on-air studio with Dr. Eric Stamberg and Robin Baker. Welcome back.
All right, welcome back. Second half hour of this morning's show. We shall be here until 9 a.m., so please feel free to call with any medical questions, comments, criticisms.
331-9255.
Really? Okay, 331-9255. Just to backtrack a little bit to gout, because I looked it up during the break, where the term comes from. It was first used around 1200 AD. They feel it's derived from the Latin word gutta, G-U-T-T-A, which means a drop of liquid. And it's derived from the idea of humorism, not humor, not ha-ha humorism, but the idea of humors, liquids and gases that kind of affect things. You know, that was an old medicine, was to get the humors out of the body. That's where a lot of the bloodletting that, Saturday Night Live so famously made fun of in their skit, came from. So it's the idea of the dropping of a morbid material from the blood in and around the joints. So that's where the gout comes from.
Very interesting.
Yes. So we talked about at the lecture what I just kind of called common orthopedic problems of the upper extremity. And this is from the point of view of a primary care physician. So it's not the same perspective as an orthopedist, although I don't think an orthopedist would disagree with what we say. But these are the type of way that things present to me. Patients will report, just kind of starting in the shoulder. It's people will kind of have two common complaints of shoulder pain, either something that's been going on a while or something that kind of just happened, or a little bit of both. I guess that's three types of complaints. You know, this time of year, a lot of people, unfortunately, are slipping on the ice. I think today, particularly, might be a treacherous day. And when you fall, you will try to break your fall. And I call that a foosh. You know what foosh stands for?
No, I don't.
It stands for a fall on an outstretched hand. Simply, where you're breaking your fall. So, obviously, you could injure yourself anywhere in that extremity. If the impact can be sustained in the shoulder and you could have the sudden onset of pain, it could affect your elbow, it could affect your wrist. Also, you know, this time of year we talked about shoveling. You know, what's going on with shoveling? You know, there'd be a lot of people are exercising in a way that they are not used to it, and that could exacerbate some underlying problem with the shoulder. A lot going on in the shoulder. You got the rotator cuff. You know what the rotator cuff is?
Not really.
Yeah, it's a family of muscles around the shoulder that help you move. And the shoulder, you know, adopt the spirit of Dr. Hansraj, is a beautiful thing. He was referring to the spine. But really, the things the shoulder can do, I mean, the types of movement. Just think of a baseball pitcher, you know, what they're doing to somehow use their shoulder primarily to throw a ball. Look at Dan's acting it out there, yes. to get a ball, you know, a ball going at 100 miles per hour. So the rotator cuff, it's actually four muscles. We don't have to get the details of them, but they work together to do all the movements of the shoulder, and muscles have tendons. So sometimes when tendons are inflamed, that will be called tendonitis. That's a term that gets thrown around a lot. You also have in the shoulder and many other joints of your body something called a bursa.
That's an open area. I know that.
The way to describe a bursa is what's called a potential space. So it means under normal conditions, it's really not open. But when it gets inflamed, it can open. And the bursa are kind of also over your body to help you move around as well. If you didn't have, you know, that's kind of how tendons move over a bone, for example. So people can have inflammation of a bursa, and that's typically called?
Bursitis.
Hey, look at you.
Thank you.
You can also have a problem in the joint itself. It seems to be getting more common, but that's what we talked about already, arthritis. We talked about the different types of arthritis. The gout was a type, but the shoulder can be more of a degenerative arthritis. And people are now getting shoulder replacements. You know, if you go back 5 years, I don't know how many of those were being done, but they're being done more commonly now.
Recently, I had a friend that had a reconstructive shoulder surgery. What did you just call it?
Shoulder replacement.
Shoulder replacement. They didn't have their shoulder replaced, but they had they had surgery on their shoulder.
Right.
And it was very interesting what they were going through in physical therapy because of all the different things like your shoulder does.
Right.
Like the inability to lift your arms above your head is one muscle group.
Right.
I'm lifting my arm above
You're
my head.
Showing. Yeah,
right?
So helpful,
I'm just,
though.
Like, I have a question. And then, but then if you have to move your elbow backwards and the muscles involved in that, or putting your hand forward, like you're going to reach for something.
Right.
They were all the different muscle groups, different types of physical therapy for each movement that they had to relearn, basically.
Right.
So it was very interesting.
Right. And actually, when people have a chronic shoulder problem, they will, especially women, will talk about difficulty putting their arm behind their head, combing their hair. And women, in particular, will report difficulty putting their bra on.
Right.
And they'll almost have to cheat, put it on the front, and then kind of, shuffle it around. And whenever I hear those stories, it's someone who has a rotator cuff problem. So it shows you how important these things are. So they could be degenerative just over time. You know, the bones can... The part of the shoulder has a bone, has to go in between the two bones, the muscles of the rotator cuff. So if the bottom of one of the areas gets a little jagged, those tendons, every time you move, are getting a little more frayed, a little more irritated. And eventually it can lead to a rotator cuff tear, which is kind of what it sounds like. Part of the muscles of the rotator cuff literally do get to
rip.
Yep. Now, if you're, who's a big pitcher these days? You following baseball? Clayton Kershaw.
Who's that one with the long hair?
A bunch of them have long hair. I think the guy in the Mets, DeGrom, got his hair cut. Anyway, we got to stick on medical topics here.
So what about the pitchers?
What about pictures? Okay. So if a Major League Baseball player gets a rotator cuff tear, he needs every bit of that rotator cuff, probably needs surgery. When the average people get a rotator cuff tear, remember, there's a lot going on. There's four muscles there. So usually you can, with physical therapy and strengthening, that little part that's torn can be replaced by the function of the other muscle. So, but some people can have a rotator cuff tear that does need surgery. You know, and actually that will manifest as someone not being able to raise their arm. You know, imagine you're in elementary school again trying to raise your hand because you have a question or something. That would be hard for patients. And that's one of the basic things. You just do it a physical exam and, lift your arms up and you'll see the person with the normal hand do this, but with this one. And then sometimes they start to cheat. You know, they use their neck a little bit and, so those are things that are, you see on just a basic exam. I do think it's important to treat this because there's a phrase that I'm sure you've heard. If you don't use it, you lose it.
I was just going to say.
Yeah. So if someone has a shoulder problem, it will continue to get worse. They'll develop something called adhesive capsulitis, which is kind of just like scarring and tightness in the shoulder capsule itself. Sometimes it's called frozen shoulder. And that's kind of like the end point that you're trying to avoid of an undertreated shoulder problem. And then that person really just has real range of motion difficulty because it's all, hasn't been used.
Frozen.
And so anyway, those are a couple basic types of shoulder problems. From a primary care perspective, what do I do to work it up? I don't always do an x-ray. It's very simple. If the x-ray is going to help me change my management, it should be done. So if I have someone say they're 75 and their shoulder's bothering them, if I do that x-ray, it might show a little arthritis in their shoulder. How's it going to change? But I talk about that with patients and certainly an orthopedist would do an x-ray. I mean, it's what they do. But it's case by case, some people are just not going to make a difference, not an immediate treatment. So I don't always do it. I don't have it in my office. They have to go to an x-ray facility. In an orthopedic office, they usually have the x-ray, right there. In urgent care, I have the x-ray right there.
Can you see a tear or a tendonitis or a bursitis in an x-ray?
No. And that's sort of, what can you see in the x-ray? Well, you can see arthritis. You can sometimes see calcium deposits in the tendons. That's got a term called calcific tendonitis. And that can kind of cause a tendonitis, just like it described, but also those calcium deposits can wind up in the joint space and cause pseudogout. See how we kind of, these topics all kind of relate to each other. We had a case in the office last week of a woman who really had sudden onset shoulder pain. And we did do an x-ray. Marianne Lyons, the nurse practitioner, was managing this case, but the x-ray showed calcific tendonitis and a very inflammatory. It is kind of like having gout in your shoulder. She was very uncomfortable. So the treatment of these problems, anti-inflammatories of some to some degree, but I am an advocate usually of shoulder of steroid injections into either the shoulder joint itself or the space on the outside of the shoulder, which is right. It's a bursa, without getting too technical, but they do communicate with each other. So I worry about the toxicity of anti-inflammatories long term, so that's just something that I always keep in mind. And I do have patients who I feel are better managed by having episodic steroid injections rather than systemic anti-inflammatories. There's only so many you can do, and you'll get some disagreement over what's that point, at which point you should be doing something else. But if I have some patients, say they're 85, and a couple times a year they feel like they come in asking for another shoulder injection, I think it's fine. I think it's a completely safe way to manage their
and problem. Better than taking like handfuls of Advil every day.
Absolutely. Again, worry about side effects, which is, if they're diabetic, it could be problematic. So you have to keep that. I think if your diabetes is controlled, I think you could have the steroid injection. But if it's not controlled, no, you have to get it under control. Sometimes I'm guilty of using that as a motivating factor for people who need to get their diabetes under better control. Get your sugars down, and then we'll talk about giving an injection.
So. I recently had an injection in my elbow.
Okay.
So, and, you know, curiously enough, I find that patients in general are pretty much underinformed. Like, either yes. We don't feel like finding out. We don't really know what's right. going on. Like, I didn't know what I needed to help this pain that I had in my elbow. But when I went to the doctor, they suggested the shot. I was very open to it. I didn't have any difficulty with it. But while he was putting the shot in, I was like, what is that exactly? Like, what are, you know, I hear steroid injection, or they say commonly cortisone injection. Like, what is that? And in very simple terms, the doctor just explained that he was directing an anti-inflammatory into that exact space where the pain was.
Right.
So as opposed to taking Advil or whatever and, right. you know, taking an oral anti-inflammatory, he was taking, a small amount in the needle and just putting it right into the joint that hurt for an almost immediate anti-inflammatory response, which is beneficial and hasn't bothered me since. So anyway, I just thought that was interesting because he was like, well, I'd like to give you this injection. And I was like, great, I'd like to have no pain anymore. But I didn't really.
Well, there are a couple points you're touching on. One is as physicians, do we do a good job of explaining to the patient what's going on? And I try.
Yeah.
You know,
a good place question is good, you know, like.
Right, right. I tell you what it's like in the office. It's, you know, it's medicine is still a volume based business. You know, more is better. And I'm not saying to endorse it. I'm saying that's the way the business is set up. So when people say, hey, I went to this doctor's office and the waiting room was packed and the doc, you know, I waited an hour or two, or the doctor spent 5 minutes with me. You know, I mean, it's all about that more conveyor belt type of thing that we're on. You know, we're trying to pull back and say maybe it shouldn't be volume based. Maybe it should be value based. But that has its own problems coming on with it. But let's revisit that topic.
We should, because common sense really speaks to the fact that nobody likes that model. The patients don't like that model, and the doctors don't like that model. I guess the insurance companies like that model.
Well, they don't either.
Bills coming through.
Remember, but they don't want to pay. So if someone is kind of motivated by volume, they're going to do more and therefore charge more and cost more. No, everyone wants to move to this model. But that merits its own discussion. Let's approach that after the break. But let's talk a little bit about your elbow, because I think we touched on the shoulder a little bit, but the elbow. What you developed was a tennis elbow, basically, otherwise known as lateral epicondylitis, but it was so inflammatory that it affected your elbow joint itself. So the tennis elbow is on the outside. If you hold your arm straight out and press right there in that part of your bone that sticks out, you know, that's
near the funny bone.
The funny bones are actually on the other side.
Oh.
So on this side, and that's where someone will get pain from tennis elbow. If you think of a tennis player, they're always doing this. That's their forearm, the forehand. So anything that extends the wrist like this will inflame it. I see it a lot in painters, you know, because they're doing this. And, just anyone who does a repetitive motion. I have no idea how you got yours.
Well, I don't play tennis, but I'm a bartender, so I'm always.
You know, bartenders get, although not at the High Falls Cafe where you work, but imagine a bar where there's the glasses are above. You know, they get shoulder problems. You know, think of all the Western movies, the bartenders
cleaning the glass and
putting it above. You know, and I actually see shoulder. We're backtracking the shoulder problems a little, but I see it a lot in our, again, those unsung heroes of the COVID era, the grocery store workers, because they're doing all day. You know, when they're usually with their left arm, which most people are righties, it's their weaker arm, and they're
sliding the groceries through.
Yeah, and they'll develop a rotator cuff inflammation as a result of doing that all day long. It's interesting.
Stocking the shelves too.
So we would have if we were cashiers,
right?
We would have to learn how to punch in numbers with our right hand.
Yeah. Are you lefty?
Yeah.
Yeah. I always say most lefties, by definition, are a little confused anyway. I mean, it's unusual to have a lefty who's a complete lefty. Like, you know, so, you know, I think it's one of the things that made me kind of a decent piano player is because, you know, the left hand's a little bit stronger and the you know, the right, you know, kind of that. It's not ambidextrous, because ambidextrous kind of means you could do the same thing with both hands. You could write with your left hand and your right hand. But what lefties do is they'll just, you know, do some things with the left hand. And then I play baseball righty, for example. I bat righty. I throw righty.
Yeah, so do I. Yeah.
I don't.
You do too, Dan?
I don't. I bat righty, but I throw left.
Yeah. See, you're confused.
Everybody learns. Yes, everybody learns how to compensate. Yeah, as you're growing up, you adopt one way or the other. I play right-handed guitar.
Hey, guitar player. Look at all the things we're learning about Dan right now.
And there's a million things that you do that, you know, you're using right-handed tools.
Right.
I mean, right now I'm using this crummer that's designed exclusively for a right-handed person, and I have to turn it around to make it work.
I'm sorry to ask what a crummer is.
A table crummer. It's those things that you swipe the crumbs off of the table with at the end of the meal. Yeah, but
did you know that?
But yeah, there's so many things, that that a left-handed person has to compensate for because the tools are designed for a right-handed person.
Right. I just remember being a kid in elementary school. You had to ask for the special lefty scissors. They'd give me the righty scissors. I'm like, you know. So,
you know what is also is unfair? I know we'll get off this left-handed, right-handed subject, is spiral notebooks. Like, right. The lefty always had to, like, lay across the spiral band on your...
You're going like this. I guess Da Vinci wrote completely upside down.
Yes.
You know? I don't know how they knew that. I mean, there's a video of Da Vinci writing. But anyway, we had in your college lecture hall, there was a special row for the lefties because...
So they didn't knock into someone?
Well, if I'm doing lefty here and I'm sitting next to a righty, we could potentially see each other's papers. You know, so you're taking a test, you're like, you know, we're acting it out. So the lefties had, we had our row all the way, if you're facing the front of the lecture hall, all the way in the right was the lefty row, a special left-handed desk where you therefore had nothing to look at except the wall of the lecture hall.
Discrimination.
Yeah. Or sometimes it was just a special row in the back or something. Yeah, it wasn't fair. No, lefty, we think we're special. I'm not sure why.
Unique.
Yes. All right. So back to your elbow. So your tennis elbow got so bad that it inflamed your elbow itself. And you required an intra-articular injection into the elbow joint.
Yeah, I couldn't straighten my arm.
Right.
Like my arm was bent all the time.
It's a little bit of a mystery why that happened to you. You had an MRI that was negative, which is good, by the way. You know, there was no bone chip that had to come out or something like that. But
they wanted to find something.
Well, I don't.
So that they would know what to do.
I wouldn't say like that. I think your orthopedist knew what to do, but the MRI was done to see if there's something else going on in there. You know, a lot of times people have what's called a loose body in their elbow joint, and then it. A little part of the bone that chipped off for whatever reason, and it's causing a problem. But no, how's your elbow feeling?
It's good, but you know, it took a really long time. It's like one of those things that, you know, if you go to the doctor and they send you to a specialist, the specialist looks at it and they say, well, I'm not going to be able to see what I need to see with an x-ray, but your insurance is not going to cover anything else unless you have an x-ray first. So I'd go for the x-ray, get the x-ray results, and then I went back, and then they ordered the next test, and then I went for another test. It was, you know, it's. I think that's something that we can all relate to on this Medical Monday show, is that it's not quite as easy to do things that you would like to do. So
right.
Even like running into these issues with the COVID vaccine and testing, also because you wish things were easier to get done. And it just seems like that was a difficult process, took a long time. But at the end of the day, I had a little elbow pain. I wasn't unable to work or I wasn't.
Yeah, but you were uncomfortable. You can also have pain on the inside of your elbow, which is kind of the opposite of the outside. So this is when people kind of have repetitive motions in their wrist that bring it closer. So when someone has a pain on the inside of the elbow, it's not called tennis elbow. It is called, have you heard of this one?
Mm-mm.
Golfer's elbow. And I think it comes from someone who's golfing at the very end of their golf swing. They're doing this. And then they'll get inflammation in that area. And it's treated. It's not as common as tennis elbow, but it is still an issue. And you don't have to be a golfer to get it. You don't have to be a tennis player to get tennis elbow. These terms are descriptive, and actually they help, you know, everyone understand what's going on.
I heard a very funny term the other day at work, washerwoman syndrome.
What was it? Was it about
hands?
Hand. Okay. I mean, do you want to give me a little more details?
It was just the diagnosis that was written down for the patient, and I just thought that was very interesting.
They're referring to a hand, maybe?
Wax on, wax off.
There are problems in the knees that are something called the nursemaid's knee and stuff like that. Because you imagine someone someone scrubbing their floor on their knees a lot. But we also talked at the lecture about problems in the wrist. Carpal tunnel is an interesting problem, very common. You know, it's something called the median nerve that comes out of the hand and goes under a tunnel and then goes into the fingers of the hand, particularly the thumb and the second and third finger will be affected by carpal tunnel. I find this interesting because, first of all, who ever heard of it 25 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago? So what's different? I mean, I'm thinking about think about a secretary from the 40s and 50s, had an old-fashioned typewriter. The old typewriters were kind of like, how would you describe it? It was like stadium seating, right? Each row was a little bit higher. And then computers came along with flat keyboards, the normal position of the wrist is to be, we call it kind of the soda can position. Make believe you're holding a soda can and the way your wrist kind of looks. You don't hold your wrist flat like this. But using a flat computer keyboard, kind of almost forcing your wrist into a non-physiologic position. And I think that has increased the risk of carpal tunnel syndrome in people who type a lot, which, by the way, is all of us. Okay. Carpal tunnel is very, very common. Actually, it's also more common in people who have conditions like diabetes and hypothyroidism. Those entities kind of just swell everything. I always think of it as they just swell everything up. But I'm a big advocate of an injection into the carpal tunnel. It's very easy to do, and it has been studied. It's about 50% effective at eradicating the symptoms. And I think it's good. I do think, maybe some people wind up getting operated on when maybe they should have tried this first before they do it. Should everyone have what's called an EMG, a nerve test, to kind of confirm the diagnosis? And it kind of comes back to the same way I evaluate patients. So, I don't know. It depends. Is this someone who at some point should have surgery? So, younger people, maybe, because if they have it at 50, they're going to have it at 60. And if someone's a little bit older, maybe not. Maybe you just make a clinical diagnosis and treat like that. If you get this nerve test, have you ever heard of this nerve test?
Oh, yeah, we order them all the time.
First of all, it's a little uncomfortable. Patients will complain about it. Literally, like kind of electric shocks on the hand. But I can tell you, confirm the diagnosis, because sometimes the symptoms of carpal tunnel can be caused by a pinched nerve in the neck. And it can give you how severe it is. Mild, moderate, severe. So I guess severe probably potentially might need to have surgery. Mild probably doesn't, and moderate's kind of in the middle somewhere. You like that?
Too hot, too cold, yeah. Just right.
I practice sometimes. I use the phrase Goldilocks medicine, where I try to practice not too much, not too little, but
just right.
And I also call it sometimes Mick Jagger medicine, because it's also you don't always get what you want, but you get what you need. And that is in the context of someone who maybe says, my shoulder hurts, I need an MRI. Well, you don't really need an MRI. What you need is this. And that's what Mick Jagger told us 50 years ago.
Or I need an antibiotic right now.
Right. We got to give you what you need, and not necessarily what you want in healthcare, but what you need. I think there's some truth in that. And then I do try to practice medicine like that.
So that's interesting that you said that you can, those carpal tunnel symptoms can be caused by a pinched nerve in your neck, because we went all the way from the shoulder, down the elbow, down to the wrist, and now the hand. So everything affects everything else.
That's right. That's right. And you know, it's not always an easy diagnosis. But there's a few basic things we do. We just kind of tap on the wrist like this, and if it kind of brings out a little tingling, that suggests it's the nerve of the wrist rather than the neck. There's a few other techniques we have to try to ascertain what the diagnosis is.
Little tricks.
Okay, we're going to go to our second break.
Back with birthdays.
We'll see. Yes, back at birthdays. All right.
Thank you, Dr. Eric Stamberg, Robin Baker. Medical Mondays. It's Monday, February 15th, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston, and this last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Central Hudson. And Mid-Hudson Valley weather and forecast goes a little like this for the next 3 days. Variable clouds with a 50% chance of snow today, a high of 27. Less than an inch of snow, though. And tonight, 100% chance of snow this evening will change to freezing rain. Low of 25. Tuesday, mostly cloudy, 90% chance of periods of rain early, and that's a high of 43 on Tuesday. It warms up a little bit. Tuesday night, partly cloudy, goes down to 16. And Wednesday, sunny with some afternoon clouds, a high up to 31. And Wednesday night, partly cloudy to mostly cloudy with a overnight, with a low of 16. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Don't. Just don't. If you see a low-hanging or downed wire, don't touch it. Don't move it. Don't go near it. Don't drive over it. It may be a power line carrying an electric current strong enough to kill. But here's what to do. Stay at least 30 feet away and call 911. Central Hudson will take care of the problem. If you come close to a wire, shuffle away with small steps and watch your step. Wires may be hidden in fallen tree limbs or near water. Your safety matters.
Hey, Dad. Your prescription will be ready in just a minute. Hey, Dad. Your laundry will be ready in just a minute. Dad, your lunch will be ready in just a minute.
Hey, honey, why don't you take a minute?
When you help care for a loved one, you give them as much time as you can. But it's just as important to take time for yourself. AARP can help. Find free care guides to support you and your loved one at aarp.org/caregiving. That's aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Diane Eastwick from Athens, New York, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
You're listening to WGHQ, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, the home of Kingston Community Radio. My name is Dan Gatiss, and it is 8:03 a.m., Monday, February 15th, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. The following segment of KCR is brought to you by Herzog's. Thinking about what really matters at Herzog's Home and Paint Center, community, family, neighborhood, all matter. Herzog's employees have been a part of the Herzog's family for years. They value personal customer service and being close to their community. Stop by Herzog's Home and Paint Center in the Kingston Plaza for all of your home building and maintenance and painting needs, and discover the difference of buying local. Sales ongoing at Herzogs.com. And let's return to the on-air studio, back with Dr. Eric Stamberg and Robin Baker. Welcome back.
All right, thank you. Welcome to the second half of this morning's show. And we are going to do some birthdays. Here you go.
February 15th, it's a Monday. And we have one birthday today, so the birthday is definitely going to be the winner of our amazing birthday gift, is the famous cow pie.
By who?
Boyce's Dairy Milk House at 62 O'Neill Street in Kingston. We'd like to wish a very happy birthday to Eleanor Ayers. And Eleanor, your friends at the Town of Ulster Senior Club wish you a very, very happy birthday, and so do we here at the show. Go by Boyce's Dairy Milk House, and you can claim your famous cow pie.
I need more cowbell. That's my Christopher Walken.
There's a whole herd in here right now.
What?
There's a whole herd in here just now.
Yeah. All right. Well, a couple things.
Well, let's just sum up. We went over the gout. We went over shoulder, elbow, and
some comedy. You brought up that washerwoman hand, and we looked it up. It's something called DeQuervain's tenosynovitis. It's a specific problem with the tendons at the base of your thumb. And okay, you know, women do tend to get this problem more than men. Now I think about it. I just never heard it called that, but it's a specific problem. There's, you know, if you look at the base of your thumb, there's a little space there with the tendons, and that's actually called, has a term called it's hard to describe over the phone, but it's called the anatomical snuff box, because in those days, people were using snuff. They would literally put it in that little space and sniff it up. Anyway, so part of the tendons there, there's get inflamed. Go in a little tunnel there and get inflamed. So that's what the diagnosis was. And that is very amenable to a steroid injection.
Well, I just think it was funny, interesting, because we were saying tennis elbow, golfer's elbow, washerwoman's hands.
Right.
It's funny.
Okay, so let's do our coronavirus update here. Okay. Cases are down. Okay, this seems to be, this hopefully is a trend that will continue. The website that I use is called Worldometer, and yesterday, and the numbers tend to be a little diminished over the weekends for probably reporting reasons, but still, yesterday only 64,000 cases being reported. I mean, just a month ago we were having 200,000 cases, fatalities yesterday were 1,100. And we are getting up to $500,000 cases of fatalities from COVID virus. Very close. So, you know, just do some basic math. We're a country of 330 million people. So if we had 130,000. Oh, gosh, let me start over because I got to clear my throat here. But we have 330 million people. To make a long story short, 500,000 basically means one out of 660 people have succumbed to COVID virus in our country. So that's one way to keep it. I know that's impressive, I think.
It's home.
All right, we do have a caller. Good morning.
Good morning. You know, we need to have a complete investigation of Ulster County's reaction to the vaccines.
Please elaborate.
Four times I have signed up with the so-called health department with telling me they're going to send me emails. I have yet to receive an email. Walgreens says, okay, you know, we're going to be doing it as of the 11th. The 11th, you couldn't get in the place. The 12th, there was nobody present whatsoever in the drugstore.
Now that
the state is saying, well, we're going to open it up to many more people, yet those who are most in need of it that fall under the, you know, if you're above 65 and you have physical problems, then you should be put on the top of the list. None of that is being done. When you call the health department, you do not get any answer. When you call Pat Ryan's office, you do not get any answer. It's time we started throwing out our local politicians because they're not serving the people. And the question has to be asked in terms of the whole state with our governor and with the way they have handled the virus. It's just been outrageous. The same with the vaccines. I have relatives in Long Island. They've all gotten their second vaccine. What's wrong with us? We don't count here in Ulster County. When are they going to shape up and start dealing with one of the critical issues in our county? For many reasons, because of what's happening to our children, what's happening to the people who are getting the virus, certainly what has happened to our nursing homes and elder care. All of this is critical problems, should be on the top of the list, and it's being ignored. How and when can we get this problem resolved? You know, can we get perhaps all our pastors, all our rabbis, mullahs have to get together with all of their constituents and communities and start a march on and surround the Ulster County's offices and just say, we want answers now and we want it corrected because this is a tragedy.
Well, I do share your frustration. As a physician, I mean, patients are constantly asking me, how do I get it? How do I get it? How do I get it? And I don't have any advice any different than what you're told already. You know, call the health department, call Walgreens, call CVS. I do think it's going to get better over the next month, and I do think there's enough blame to go around, starting all the way at the top in Washington, D.C., with not enough supply of the vaccine being distributed.
Now they keep adding things. Now they want you to give proof of your problems.
Well, that's a good point, because that also, by the way, I don't want people to feel sorry for me, but it does make my day more difficult.
Absolutely. That it's unfair for that, and especially if your person is elderly, you know, and goes way beyond 65, there should be no question whatsoever. But now they got to wait for their doctors and their offices to go through, which is a big burden on them when they're trying to deal with other questions and with, you know, patients, especially those that have a lot of elderly patients. I mean, people need to start speaking out and putting the pressure on the leaders of our community, not the politicians. They don't give a damn. But just start calling them and saying, we're putting you on a list that you refuse to act on behalf of our citizens in the time of crisis. And know this, we will keep putting this list out in every way possible. And so don't look for future, you know, support on the part of the people when you run for office.
Okay. Yeah. I agree. I think I just think there's enough blame to go around. I think it is a tragedy how the vaccine has been rolled out with not enough supply, and then the not having an infrastructure in place to administer the vaccine. I agree with you completely with that.
Oh yeah. Now the New York City and Long Island are hiring people from up here to go down and administer the vaccines.
Something, there is a distribution concern. I agree with you in that. And then we do have more problems, you know, where stories of people in New York, the people who are getting the vaccine in New York City, for example, don't even necessarily live in New York City. Mm-hmm. You know, we have a problem of getting the word out to parts of the population in the state and in the city as well. People who actually are also higher risk because they maybe live in smaller quarters and maybe they have jobs that require them to be, you know, in contact with people. So there's enough blame to go around, though. I do agree with that.
Yeah, well, people can wake up and start going and bombarding your politicians.
I think that's okay.
And saying you want it done. But thank you for your program, because it certainly is critical of informing we the people. So thank you.
I will say, yeah. All right, well, thanks for listening. And thanks for, I appreciate your input. I really do.
Thank you.
Okay. I mean, it is true that I gave up on trying to reach out to the health department to maybe come on the show because they just didn't seem interested. It was several months ago, but I made several calls to the health department saying, hey, just call into the show. Let's give some information out and something about having their own show and people could tune into that. I don't even know, so. But I don't think that they, you know, this is a once-in-a-century health crisis. Hopefully it's going to be more than a century before it happens again.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to understand the caller's frustration. I mean,
yes.
I think we all feel that we're on the same boat. How do you...
Right, and I don't think you need a letter if you're already in a higher risk category. So we can review that. It's for someone who is... not like someone who's maybe 55 who has asthma, you know, for example. Mm-hmm. All right, good morning, caller.
Good morning. I was one of the fortunate ones. I did get my first vaccine, and I'm due to get it this Wednesday, my second one. And I have questions about the second shot.
Okay.
Okay, first of all, I'd like to go back to the first one. The first one, I know you get really a very small amount of the vaccine. And, you know, the needle's really small, and, you know, you just get, like, a little pain in your arm later, which I had very little of that. But with the second shot, what is different about it that so many people, you know, get side effects from it? You know, like they get fever sometimes, they get aches and pains and chills and all that kind of stuff. Do they give a large amount of it or a stronger amount of it? Or, you know, what is that?
It's a good question, but it's not the dose is the same. What's different is the patient is different. So if you're given the first dose, your body starts reacting to it, makes antibodies. And when you get the second dose, those antibodies kind of pounce a little bit And that's why put it very simply, that's why the second dose is associated with more side effects than the first. In a way, it illustrates a good reaction. I know it's hard to explain to someone who's not feeling well as a result of the vaccine, but it does show that your body's responding to the vaccine. But it's not the dose. The dose of the vaccine is the absolutely same.
Uh-huh. Okay, because that was, like I said, it's so strange that it's so different from the first one and the second one, that this happens. And probably other people are wondering why, too, this was happening, And
yeah, I agree. And I've been telling people, I say we shouldn't mislead, okay? The vaccine has a lot of side effects. And they give you a handout that explains these side effects. They're very high percentages. I wish I had it in front of me, but 80% of people with achiness, I mean, it's very high. I tell my patients, yes, you should get the vaccine, and yes, you should be prepared for side effects. If you're working, be prepared to maybe have to take the day off the next day. Have some Tylenol on hand to help you through it. And the side effects do tend to be short-lived, 12 to 24 hours.
Okay, good. And then I hope that the people who are really, trying to get it, they can get it. Because we were very fortunate. With the building I live in here, I live in senior housing here in Saugerties, and they came in here and they gave it. And then also the mill in Saugerties had gotten it, but I had gotten mine already 5 days before that. I had gone up to Woodstock, and I had gotten it up there. But I know a lot of people who are really having a hard time to find out where they're going to get it, and I just hope that more places become available here in Ulster County,
I agree. I do think it's going to get better, but that other caller, I understand his frustration completely. I'm not so sure I would put so much blame on the local politicians. I do think that there's, I think this is a statewide problem. I don't think it's Pat Ryan's fault, for example, that too many doses are going to Long Island. My guess is he's trying to get every dose possible to Ulster County.
Uh-huh.
But there, there might be a little bit of neglect to the smaller counties going on a statewide basis. But we're getting a little maybe too much into politics, but I do think it will get better. I started the show by talking about how I was impressed by CVS when I walked in there on Saturday. They had a system in place and they were doing it. There's a lot of catch up to be done. It's a lot of work that we need to do. And I hope CVS and Walgreens, and I wish there was a way to get all the pharmacies involved, Nico's, Dedrick's, and maybe that's a problem with the way the state and the country are handling it, because they're doing it through the bigger pharmacies,
Yeah, right, because I know I've had people call me because somehow or other my name has been on the call list for the senior center up in Saugerties, and people called me wanting to know, where they could get the vaccine if something was going to be set up at the center up there and stuff like that, And I haven't been able to tell them. I've been telling them, call the mayor up, because when we got the vaccine here where I live, it was all set up by the mayor here in Saugerties.
Sure. Yeah. So, right. Again, I don't think it's the – I think the local politicians are probably doing their best. I mean, I don't I'd like to see maybe the health department do a little more outreach. I haven't really experienced that, But by the way, the president, President Biden, ordered 300 million doses to be made and distributed. That's enough to vaccinate 150 million people. So the supply problem will improve. It's kind of a shame that we didn't have this many already going. I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, when it went on in the past, I hope it doesn't continue on again. I do believe that Joe Biden is really stepping up there, I feel that when Trump was in office and he made such, light of it and stuff like that, even though he had come down with it, saying it was always turning around. When it wasn't turning around, it was getting worse, so I just hope now with the new administration that everything will go forward more, and
sure,
more people will be helped.
Yeah, I try to steal steer short of making, you know, getting too involved with politics. So you're allowed to express your opinion. Robin and I will leave it at that.
And good luck with your second shot coming up this week. And thanks so much for calling.
Yeah, very welcome. And take
care. Kind of like treat it like a dental appointment. You know that there's going to be a little discomfort, you know, and just be prepared for it.
Yeah, I will. Okay, take care.
All right, thank you.
Okay, bye.
Yep. You know, it's a big deal. You know, the shot is important, but it comes with a price. And I just think people, I'm worried. I'm worried that people are going to maybe not get the shot because they hear so much bad things about it, you know.
Right, but as you just said, the bad thing really isn't a bad thing.
No.
The fever, the not feeling well, the feeling under the weather is that your body is responding, and that the benefits of the vaccine are inside you. So it's not a bad thing.
Right. Most of my patients are open to the vaccine. A few are skeptical. A few have said they're not getting it. They don't like the way it was rolled out. I'm not sure what they're talking about, but I just look at them and say, look, I got the vaccine. Do you think I would have done it if I didn't think it was safe or important? You know, do you not, you know, respect my opinion? You know, I think you should get the vaccine. So.
Right. No, I, right.
All right. So there is a downward trend in the numbers. We hope it continues. I haven't heard too much over the past week or so about the new strains. Remember that was kind of making the news, I'm a little nervous about that. There is evidence that the vaccines to some degree will cover those new strains as well. So that's important. I think what we're seeing is, you know, we predicted it, and we, not me personally, but the medical establishment, that there was going to be a surge after Thanksgiving and Christmas. And now that people are kind of wintered in for January and February, we're seeing a kind of taper off. So hopefully it's the beginning of a trend that will continue. And the numbers have also leveled off locally as well. Do you think we should say anything else?
I just think that you should still stay vigilant, you know, still use all the precautions that you have been using. I know there was a study that came out recently about double masking and,
right.
You know, people have, you know, some people have a difficult time with just one mask. Just follow the guidelines.
Masking. I actually, one problem with people who wear glasses is the mask will cause the glasses to fog up. I found that double masking improves that problem. So just keep that in mind. Maybe just a kind of a little extra. So I get two masks right now.
Covering, yeah. So just, but, you know, staying diligent with hand washing, keeping your 6-foot distance. I think that regular people got sick after the holiday. Like people who weren't exposed to COVID this entire time did become exposed because of visiting and because
right. another thing that I noticed because I drive past it every day is the urgent care in Rosendale for October, November, December, you know, people waiting outside to get COVID testing.
Right.
I have not quite noticed that when I've driven by it recently. So that also suggests that the man, and by the way, I worked urgent care on Saturday here in Kingston. And this was a site that was doing as many as 100 COVID tests a day. Maybe 20, you know, so that's.
Right. So maybe we're leaning more towards vaccinating as opposed to testing right now.
Right. I think it's, you know, these things always have kind of multifaceted explanations. I think the vaccine is part of it. I think just the seasonality of it. Again, I think people are wintered in right now, not really going out, not doing much socially. And I think, maybe at least for now, the tide has subsided and we'll keep our fingers crossed. You know, when spring comes, you'll maybe see a mixed report. You know, on one hand, you know, people are going to be outside more and the contagious nature is not as so serious in an outside environment. On the other hand, people maybe will start kind of getting together again and socializing. So we'll have to see what happens. But the vaccine problem will continue to improve. I will say that with confidence. And I just saw people at CVS working very hard. And I appreciated that very much. Let's talk about me.
okay.
Yeah, he was my show. it's funny, you know, the business of medicine. It's so hard to talk about anything without talking about the business of medicine. But this comes from a journal called Medical Economics. I read it every month. The 2021's top challenges facing physicians. And some of them not going to evoke very much sympathy from the listening population, which I understand. I really do. You know, I think that as doctors, we do tend to complain a lot. And it's important for us to step back and go, stop it. But anyway, so the top 10 challenges, this is a survey. And I thought they were all interesting because it gives a perspective of what it's like from our perspective. So number one was administrative burdens and paperwork. Is that something that you think is a problem?
It's a lot of paperwork.
Yeah. It's not good. I had to get on the phone just to show you how complicated it gets and how frustrating it is. A couple things came up just last week. One of my Suboxone patients, this is a woman actually in her early 70s, who's otherwise healthy, fairly healthy, and you know, she had it prescribed to her for pain reasons and unfortunately did develop an addiction to opioids. And we have her maintained on Suboxone, a relatively low dose, and new year. And guess what? Her insurance plan was not covering it. It starts by them getting I prescribe it. And then immediately get a message, needs a prior auth. I go, okay, you know, roll my eyes, grit my teeth a little bit, you know, and say, I guess we'll have to do a prior auth. So we do the prior auth, and then it comes back and says, thank you for your prior auth, but the medication is not covered. So I don't know why they, you know, so immediately they're making me spin my wheels a little bit. So the patient had her appointment, and with the patient right there, I got on the phone. I called first her prescription provider, who were the ones that the letter is from, who said, oh, yeah, we're not dealing with that. You have to call the plan directly. So I called the plan directly, again, with the patient sitting right there. And I explained the situation to someone. They said, oh, yeah, you have to call our compliance number. So I called the compliance. So now I'm making the third call for the patient. And I talked to this person who says, well, that's being covered by Medicare directly. And then they also said, oh, we mailed something to the patient. And then that really kind of triggered me because I said, stop it, okay? You know, just because you mailed something to the patient in October doesn't help her with the fact that her medication is not being covered right now. I mean, you know, again, that mentality, somehow that somehow they told the patient, therefore the patient knew, and somehow that makes things should have known. You know, I really wasn't buying that. I didn't appreciate that. So we actually, the conversation got a little tense, but eventually the woman said she'll talk to the patient directly about how to get this done, and I said, fine, and I didn't hear anything else, so maybe it resolved, but that was a good, it's not quite the same thing as paperwork, but certainly the fact that the whole visit, which should have been more on the patient's, how she's doing, and some other medical problems, was spent on the phone with insurance companies. So that's a biggie. Number two in the list is having to see enough patients. So this kind of touches on what we were talking about, that medicine is still a volume-based business. And, you know, it's almost like it's like never enough, you know. And by the way, corporations kind of do this to the providers that they employ. You know, they'll say, and I'm not saying my organization, which, by the way, does not do it, at least not to me. But they'll say, hey, doc, you know, in 2020 you saw this much and we want to set the goal a little bit higher, so we want you to do this much, you know. So that kind of constant message that what you're doing isn't enough. And the fact that that's how you get paid, by seeing more and doing more, not necessarily doing better. But that was number two on the list. Any comments?
No. Okay. I'm listening.
All right. And by the way, these things on the list, I don't think they're mutually exclusive. I think they all feed into each other. Because number three on the list is physician burnout and autonomy. The idea of burnout, you know, is not exclusive to the medical profession, but the medical profession suffers from it. And if you compare it to like the legal profession, the legal profession has a much lower rate of burnout. Not to say it doesn't exist. But there's just something, a disconnect in what we're trying to do all day and how it's being done. I think that, you know, that was a good example that I had to get on the phone and, you know, talk to some people that are not physicians. They're clerical people that, I found that frustrating. So the idea of not having autonomy as well, you know, kind of having an entity, you know, kind of, for example, telling you to see more patients. By the way, not my organization. I just want to say that for the record. My organization is supportive of you know, the type of practice that I'm running, right? You know, my own practice, my own patients.
It's just not, it's not good common sense. I mean,
what do you mean?
Isn't. Because, I mean.
Oh, look at that. We got to go to a break. Hold that thought.
Okay.
Mid-sentence. That's okay. Just remember the end of the sentence when we come back. Thank you, Robin Baker and Dr. Eric Stamberg. It's now at the bottom of the hour, and you're with us on Kingston Community Radio, KCR at AM 920 and 92.5 FM. Monday, February 15th, and 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And because the colors and quality of paint you choose matters, Herzog's Paint and Design Center, located in the Kingston Plaza, is there for you, offering the largest selection of Benjamin Moore paints and the area's most complete line of painting supplies. Herzog's Paint and Design Center also provides color samples from Benjamin Moore paints, including the eco-friendly Aura line. Color decorating consultants and expert interior designers are ready to assist you in choosing the right colors and more for your home. Visit Herzog's in the Kingston Plaza, and you can find them at herzogs.com also. We'll be right back after these messages.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
As the world faces the challenges of the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, Lions recognize that kindness matters now more than ever. And Lions and Leos are finding ways to continue to serve our communities. For more than 100 years, in times of need, Lions always find a way to help those around them. And after we emerge from this, we will be stronger than ever. Visit lionsclubs.org to learn more.
I'm Haley Kiyoko, and I know what it's like to struggle with mental health issues. If you have a friend that's going through a tough time, now is the perfect moment to reach out. Learn how to start the conversation at seizetheawkward.org.
Brought to you by the Ad Council, the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, and the Jed Foundation.
Hi, this is Dina Roy from Hurley, and I support the Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
And we're back. And this is Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. Monday, February 15th, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And this upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, a location near you. And let's get back to the on-air studio with Robin Baker and Dr. Eric Stamberg. Welcome back.
All right, thank you. Welcome to the last half hour of this morning's show. Robin, you were in the middle of a thought. Do you remember what it was?
I was just saying that we often talk about that give and take between the doctor and the patient. The doctor and the patient are really a team. And really, the goal of this team is they both want the same outcome. The doctor and the patient want to feel better.
Right.
They want to live well. They want to feel better if they don't feel well.
Right.
And all of this other stuff that gets put in the way is contradictory to making things happen quickly or efficiently. I mean, I joke with patients at the office all the time. We're like, we're a paperless office. with the papers flying out of the.
By the way, paper is just you could have paper in your computer. It's just technically not paper. It's still paperwork.
Right. So.
And you're right. Yeah, there still is tons of paper in the paper. Tons of paper. Tons of paper. Yes.
And they're like, because we offer the patient a clinical visit summary as soon as when they leave their appointment, so that right. they have some idea of what just happened right, because right. it's so hard to remember.
But a lot of that is also kind of so computer generated. That, you know, whatever meaning there is to extrapolate from it, it's not always easy to see.
Right. It's a little bit difficult.
Right.
But, yeah, so I just wanted to just reiterate that point that we often stress. Me being here from the patient perspective and you there with the physician perspective, that really, it sometimes seems like we're at odds, but we really are not. We're on the same side, the
right.
same team. And it is a lot of other outside entities that are like causing us difficulty. I think your story was very interesting about your patient that you had done. How many tasks is that if you add it up? The patient needs their medication, so you call their medication in. You have to make sure it's the right medication. You have to make sure it's not interacting with any other drugs that she's taking. You have to make sure it goes to the correct pharmacy that she uses. You have to make sure it's the right codes that it's going to be covered by her insurance company. So you sent that. That's your first thing. Immediately, you're sent back a request from the insurance that it needs a prior authorization. So your first request was not good enough. You have to send another request restating the reason the patient needs the medication and confirming that this patient needs the medication that you already prescribed, that you already said that the patient needed, and then
my gosh, it sounds like you know that stuff.
Therein, right, and therein, forcing another task to be done. Now, this is you haven't seen the patient yet. Patient didn't even come into the appointment. This is you trying to refill a medication for your patient that you know the patient needs. So then, on top of that, there's another 3 phone calls that are made during the patient's visit, which I think is probably valuable for the patient to see that her doctor is really advocating for them. And but what a patient should know, that even if the doctor's not doing something like calling someone on the phone during your appointment, that what they're doing behind the scenes for you is it's incredibly complicated and in depth.
Right.
And I get calls all day long at the office saying, well, I just need this refill, or I just need this, or I just need that. And I just feel like patients should just understand that when you just need a refill, what that means on the part of your doctor and how much work that initiates. This morning, if you were able to listen earlier, Dr. Stamberg was going on about different medications that can help with one specific illness. We were discussing the gout.
Okay.
But there were, I don't know, every other sentence he was talking about an interaction. So if you're diabetic, you can't take this kind of medication. Or if you're hypertensive, you can't take this medication. If you're on furosemide, you can't take this medication to help this problem. This is a very in-depth thinking process that has to, and the doctor has to review all your medications, make sure that there really are no interactions so that they can help you with your one specific problem that's bothering you today. So I think just a little understanding of, you know, each other is really important.
Well said. I think it's the first day we did this show. I think we talked about that. We talked about kind of the idea of triangulation and how, you know, anyone who's ever studied, like in to be a therapist, whatever, they talk about triangles as dysfunctional relationships. You think about an adolescent kid with parents and the parents maybe not functioning together, and then how the kid might have a hard time with that, you know. So medicine is a classic triangulated entity where you have the patient, you have the doctor or healthcare provider, and then you have the entity that is kind of paying for stuff. You know, that could be the government, Medicare, it could be Medicaid, or it could be a private insurance company. And just that's inherently dysfunctional. And that's sort of what you're seeing. So the fact that the patient might wind up frustrated with the doctor because something's not done right when it's really being done by the insurance company, that's where they should direct their frustration. The doctor, as you always say, you know, I don't prescribe medications to not have them covered or test to not have them done. I want them done. So, that's what happens.
So I guess it was just a little bit of a patient perspective comment on a physician feeling a type of burnout. That is very frustrating for a physician.
Right.
To have to do all of those tasks to just accomplish one goal for their patient and to be put in that kind of constraint. It's Right.
Yeah, so that was the physician burnout and autonomy is on the list. And it's, by the way, it's important, and it's important for the patient. You know, they study this, by the way, burnt out physicians so much. They can make more mistakes. They can not interact as positively with the patient. They can, what else? The communication will suffer. I mean, so this all kind of comes down on the same page, you know, and this is not something that people thought about 25 years ago, that their doctors were burnt out. Maybe they were to some extent, but it is a problem. Hiring and retaining staff, certainly that's something I don't worry about as much. I used to be in private practice in Rosendale. But that being said, there have been some problems with staffing and maybe it's COVID, maybe it's not, you know, trying to find people to fill spots on the staff, you know, and that's an ongoing struggle, I think, in many businesses. But here's a biggie, though, which is electronic health record usability, you know, this entity now, another entity that's in the room constantly. You know, I bring it in the room with me. I stare at it all day long. This electronic health record, this kind of a presence, and how frustrating that can be for many different reasons. And I'm always very sympathetic if a patient goes to a specialist, and I'll say, hey, how was Dr. So and so? And they'll say, well, you know, she had her back to me, you know, at the computer the whole day and the whole appointment, I mean. And I'm like, I get it. You know, I wish it wasn't that way, but I'm certainly not blaming the doctor for that. You know, this is, I usually have a laptop and I kind of have the laptop positioned, you know, in the same way I would have had a paper chart, you know, on my lap, you know, the same thing. And I'm kind of, you know, in the old days, I would maybe be, you know, looking through the chart while we talk, trying to find some recent tests or whatever. And I'm kind of doing that on the computer, which, you know, unfortunately might give the impression sometimes that maybe I'm not paying attention. You know, this is kind of the art of medicine, you know. So I usually kind of deal with that just by telling the patient, you know, I'm listening. I'm just trying to find this your last set of labs or whatever, you know. And they usually seem to understand that. Have you had an experience where you felt that the computer was kind of a intrusive presence?
Not at my own personal doctor's appointments, but I do hear it as a patient complaint. I know that we were with your father at a certain appointment, and the doctor's computer was faced up against a wall.
Yeah.
So the doctor just turned his back to us and was, you know, typing in the computer without even turning or even looking in our direction, which I thought was, but it really wasn't his fault. Like, the computer was stuck on the wall. He couldn't even pick it up and turn it around. It was like a bad design, but it didn't help me.
It was a bad design.
It didn't help me feel better.
No.
Not even having him look at us. So
I agree with that. It was he had gone to see a specialist about having the watchman procedure, which is on the television. He was not a candidate for that, but you know, yes, that doctor kind of had the back to us, and that was the way the room was set up, and it was frustrating.
Yeah, you know, one of the worst things you want to feel when you're with a doctor is to feel dismissed or, you know, not seen at all.
Right.
So that was tough.
The next one is hard, kind of, you know, hard to talk about without sounding like I'm just protecting my turf, you know, but it is relevant. It's called just increased competition. You know, it's always kind of a theme, especially in primary care, that we're not doing enough. We're not accessible enough. Our hours aren't good. It's too hard to make an appointment. You know, I can't get in today. Can't get in for a month or whatever. You know. So the idea of increased competition, and I was, you know, you and I were ahead of our time when we were talking about telemedicine kind of being marketed as this alternative to your primary care provider. And now we were kind of saying, you know, not so fast, you know. I think the shine of telemedicine has kind of worn off. I think, you know, many people are choosing to just do it the old fashioned way. You know, it's what they're used to. It's easier. So I found that a little reassuring, actually. I think there will always be a role for telemedicine, and I think there are patients that, you know, I don't have them need to come in the office. We can talk on the computer or talk on the phone to go over labs and make some adjustments to medications. I think that's okay. But, Anyway, so that's one form of competition. So they're saying, hey, you have to be more available. You have to have, you know, the whole idea that the appointment has to be easy to schedule. A lot of emphasis on scheduling online appointments now, where we're kind of rolling that out. I'll see how that goes. You make the wait time as little as possible. You know, it's one of the frustrations of primary care. I mean, the standard is people should be seen within 15 minutes of their appointment. I mean, but the irony, you know, have you ever gone to a crowded urgent care on a Saturday?
And people wait 2-3 hours.
Waiting. Right. So, again, that difference in standard. Somehow the primary care office, if you're waiting more than 15 minutes, there's something wrong with your provider. But if you go to a specialist office, you know, also the wait is longer, you know, so it's very hard to keep up with that standard. I think the number one reason that I might run behind is actually kind of patients showing
patient
up a little bit
care.
Late. You know, if I have a 15-minute slot at 9 and someone shows up at 9:05, you know, I'm usually seeing them by 9:10, you know, already that appointment is behind schedule.
And add to that, like good patient care, if the patient has one more thing they have to discuss with you,
right.
You're not chewing them out the door and right. telling them to stop talking to you. You're going to finish with the visit. So,
and I think that whole, you know, this is done by an industry. How long do you have to wait? The question should really be, how did you feel after your visit? Did you feel like, you know, because most, I've heard it said many times over the years. I mean, some doctors in our community, they kind of had a reputation for maybe running behind. But at the same time, patients felt that doctor gave them.
Worth the wait.
Worth the wait. So, you know, it makes me scratch my head a little bit, because if it's kind of the business model of medicine, the most important factor should be if you're getting a good product, you know, not how long you wait, you know. Anyway, so that's an example of something that's this high standard that's being held on particularly the primary care physician. And it's really, I don't know, it's hard to meet. They say the waiting room should be more comfortable. You should have coffee. You know, I could see that, but I could also see problems with coffee. What happens to coffee? It spills, right? And then, you know, and maybe, who knows? Wi-Fi, furniture should be nice. I don't know. It's just transparent pricing is something they talk about a lot. I have a hard time understanding that argument. If you have a model where the person is paying for something directly, hey, I'm going to see the doctor. It's costing me $75. But that's not the model. The person has a copay if they have an HMO, for example, maybe $25.
Sometimes a deductible.
And putting up a price is not going to, you know, the price for that patient is, say it's their copay. It's $25. They don't, what else do they need to know? I mean, so I'm not quite understanding that argument. That the transparency or lack of transparency is kind of put in place by a three-party system. You know, my organization has a contract with many different organizations who potentially pay different amounts. I mean, that kind of discrepancy is just part of the business. Saving for retirement, I think that's something that everyone will share. So I don't think that problem is unique to the medical profession. And the transitioning to value-based care models made the list, and we talked about that earlier. The problem I'm having with that is I think we're just kind of exchanging one set of frustrations for another. You know, if they could say, hey, doc, you saw 20 patients today, you know, good busy day, you know, or they're going to say, hey, you know, doc, you saw, you know, 20 patients today, but, you know, this diabetes isn't controlled well enough, this blood pressure's not controlled well enough, this person needs to get this mammogram done or whatever, you know, and that's sort of where the value-based care kind of comes in. But I just worry that they're kind of trading one kind of artificial measurement for another, you know.
Well, I think it all comes down on how do you measure something. I mean, we find this all the time with statistics with everything, right? In education, they use statistics. They use one test to test every child.
Right.
A standardized test. When these are individuals, they're not exactly the same, but they have to measure it somehow. And honestly, the measurement is always connected to a payment of some right. sort. So how much money is the school district going to get? Well, it's based on their standardized testing.
Right.
Well, how much money is the doctor going to make? It's based on a standardized test. How good is this doctor at being right. a doctor? When really, you know, any teacher will tell you. Let's talk about the 15 man hours that went into individually tutoring this particular student on this particular issue, on the one question on a particular test. I mean, you're not measuring that kind of attention. You're just going by the standardized score. And we often talk about with you, like, does anybody measure your patients who aren't accessing the hospital, or your patients that are not having something go wrong with them because they are well taken care of, or do they just look at the bad, the numbers that are incorrect?
And I also worry about cherry picking. They use a phrase in our business, and it's not a good phrase. Heavy utilizers. You know, those are people who use a lot of healthcare resources. Maybe they're sick, by the way. Maybe they got, bad lungs or cardiac condition or so on and so forth. And then there's also usually some social issues that stand in the way. Maybe they're bad insurance. Maybe they don't have insurance. Maybe they, even though they have insurance, they can't afford the medicine that I'm prescribing. Maybe the medicine wasn't covered and they just kind of threw up their hands and they're just not taking it, that type of thing. So many different factors. And the idea is to target those heavy utilizers, reach out to them, get them more involved with their outpatient care. So therefore, maybe they don't go to the emergency room so much and maybe they don't deteriorate and wind up getting admitted, for their CHF or for their COP. And then that'll make sense. But you have to, if you're going to measure me on outcomes, you have to somehow allow for that, those challenging cases. And I worry about a culture where no one's going to want those challenging cases, just like teachers are kind of disincentivized to take care of, kids who maybe need some extra help. And I think that's a big problem, kind of like the potential for cherry picking. People, what's to stop a physician from saying, you want to be my patient? Let me see your medical records, reviewing the medical records and saying, hey, you're too complicated. I have a system now that's going to punish me for taking care of you, not reward me for taking care of you. Because in addition to all the work it's going to take to help you, I'm now going to be judged on that, it's a big, 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 big problem that needs to be addressed if this value-based system's ever going to take off. And
the irony there is that any good doctor, we say a doctor worth his stuff, is like, great, bring it on.
Right.
You have some issues, and I know how to help you, and we're going to be a team, work together, and you're going to get better. That was why you became a doctor in the first place. You didn't would not want to help people. You went into the business because you did want to help people. And a teacher doesn't want to not teach a student. Right. Give me your most challenging student. Let me show you what I can do.
Right.
But being penalized for trying to help those kinds of kids or those kinds of patients, that's a disincentive. That's not an incentive.
Right. Right. And then, I talked about that in a meeting not that long ago where we were just kind of discussing the topic. If you go back to, I've been around long enough, when I first started, I think this doctor's a good doctor. A specialist would call me, say, hey, I got a patient, got a lot going on. I recommended that they call you to establish primary care. The idea that the complicated cases were for the, you were up to the job. That meant you were a good doctor. They had confidence in you. Now it's kind of like, this person's numbers are bad and they're going to the ER too much and there must be something wrong with your care. And it's a big problem. I don't know the solution. They talk about what's called an HCC, which is kind of a case complexity score and how it kind of factors into how it's assessed, but it's not finding its way into how I'm individually assessed. It's complicated. I just think if we're really going to make a meaningful transition to value-based care, we've got to address that problem. You can't disincentivize doctors and other healthcare providers for taking care of the sickest of the sick and the most complicated. Anyone could have a practice with healthy, 65-year-olds who were doing yoga and, what about people who are, doctors who are trying to take care of some of the more challenging members of the Kingston population, for example? And
yeah, and thank God you're here. Yeah. I mean, that's what you want. You want to keep you incentivized, not disincentivized.
It's a big problem with rural medicine. It's why, you know, what are the most people don't want to practice in a real rural setting. It's going to be a tremendous amount of work because you don't have resources. Cases are going to be complicated. People have a lot of health problems. There's going to be some payment problems. You know, people may be, for example, on Medicaid, which does pay doctors less money. I mean, it's a lose for someone who's willing to go in there. Sometimes they'll say, oh, okay, we're going to give you some loan forgiveness. I mean, you know, some of the residents I work with and medical students, I don't even want to know how much money they owe. It's a lot of money. But, you know, so they'll say, okay, you know, if you come work here for 3 years, we're going to give you this much to pay off your loans. So that person will go there and work 3 years in one day and then leave, you know, and then they'll start the process over.
Doesn't help you keep a good doctor in that community.
No. So it doesn't fix the problem, you know. So loan forgiveness is really not the right solution. You have to make it doable so someone can practice medicine in that environment you know, do the work that they were trained to do and feel kind of rewarded for it, and not just financially. You know, remember, if you're doing value-based care, you're kind of giving doctors a report card. So you're not it's just about money. You know, the report card's not good. So basically they're saying, hey, look at that. You're not doing a good job. I don't know, you know, if we scare you away, I don't know who's going to come in. But anyway, so we do have a big problem, even in areas just an hour away from where we are now, into Delaware County and Sullivan County. And, you know, the need for, you know, these towns used to have some GPs and FPs in them. And it's just not happening anymore.
So general practitioners or a family practitioner.
Yeah. Yeah. We talked about that. You know, a GP was... You used to be able to practice medicine by going to medical school and then doing just 1 year of an intern, and then you could hang a shingle, and that was a GP, whereas other doctors would maybe then go specialize in surgery or OBGYN or orthopedics or something. Around 1970, the field of family practice was created to kind of substitute that. It became accepted that wasn't really enough. You had to go to medical school in 1 year. You needed more training in order to practice. And that's sort of where the idea of family medicine came up, you know, as a replacement for the old-fashioned GP. But it does have its own 3-year residency, not just 1 year. People are confused about that.
Mm-hmm.
There still are some GPs. Not really. There were. I think they've all kind of aged out. But there were. And by the way, they practice great medicine. You know.
I think so interesting your comment about rural medicine and saying that, well, if they had the resources, I mean, it comes down to resources in any practice.
Right.
And you can't really talk about resources without talking about the state of the insurance industry and the state of the pharmaceutical industry. And you can't really talk about those things without reaching into politics somehow. So, yes, it does become political, unfortunately, for the doctors and for the patients.
Yeah, so that, anyway, that's a big problem, you know, to get doctors to practice where, kind of like the USS Enterprise, where no one else wants to go, you know, and make it a model that's doable. Some people don't think we have a doctor shortage. We have a doctor distribution shortage. You know, areas like Boston and New York City have many, many doctors, you know, a lot of medical schools. You know, it's a question of getting people to practice in areas where they're needed.
So if you had to sum up in 2 minutes, what would be some good incentives from your perspective to have somebody leave New York City and go somewhere else to practice? Let's say.
It's got to be, you know.
You know, Oswego.
Well, Oswego is at least a town not too far from Syracuse, but no, but good point, I guess, Oswego. Their money does matter. I mean, if someone is getting a salary here and all of a sudden I get those emails sometimes, job offers, come practice here, and then you ask a few questions, you know, the salary's not competitive, you know. So that's, yeah. Why would someone go take on a new job for a lower amount of money? More challenging, by the way. So yes, you have to have equitable salaries. And the job has to be doable. You have to have resources, which means staffing. Anyway, we're going to call it for the week. We'll be back in March. I can't believe we're already talking about March, but we'll see you in 2 weeks.
Thank you, Dr. Eric Stamberg and Robin Baker, for bringing us this this day of Medical Mondays. Monday, February 15th, 25 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Many locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, locations near you. And thank you for sharing the morning with us and participating in Kingston Community Radio, KCR AM 920 and 92.5 FM, WGHQ, and our live streaming on mykcr.org. Talk radio at its best, inspired discussions of, by, and for the community. And thank you, callers, for calling in, and especially thank you, listeners, for being a part of Kingston Community Radio's community. Until tomorrow at 7 a.m., we wish you every success in growing and developing Kingston and all our neighboring communities. Good morning and good day.
Can dance to the radio right up till dawn, till you drift off to dream in my arms.